For me, I think a voice and a song in particular carries with it a human experience at its simplest and often its rawest. Music has always been a vehicle for the spirit of people, the spirit of the times and the stories of people. And where we believe those stories, that's empathy in action. And that's where action can begin. And I could cry. I'm Hozier, and this is Cry Power, my podcast about people who are using what's available to them to change the world. Presented with our friends at Global Citizen, on each episode I'll be sitting down with people who are putting themselves out there to support a cause that's dear to them. I'll be talking to people whose work is making a real difference, musicians, artists, or just some of my heroes. Thank you. Thank you, Ifrah, for joining me on the Cry Power podcast. I want to say, first of all, a huge welcome and thank you for your time. I know you have a very busy schedule today. I know we've been kind of, I've been on your heels the last few days, so you've been travelling and doing as much chatting to people as I have. And congratulations over the last few years, with some incredible milestones I'm looking forward to speaking to you about. But thank you for joining me here in Dublin.
Thank you for having me. Actually, it's really great platform for my campaign and the cause, and you know, in the young Irish generation to actually hear more and listen to it. So it's really amazing that you picked it.
First of all, your personal story is an incredible one. For those who aren't aware, and just to give a broad picture for people, you set up the Ifrah Foundation, which is working towards legislation. Both here, which has been a huge success, and in Somalia also, in banning the practice of female genital mutilation. Just to give a broad, you know, a picture to those who wouldn't be familiar, would you mind?
No, as you said, female genital mutilation, because usually, you know, just some of the people who actually talk to others, they just, in short, they say FGM, and a lot of people would not really understand, but... Female genital mutilation is cutting, and it's just actually a cultural practice. And for example, in Somalia, 98% community do practice, where I come from originally. And it practiced 54 countries, including some of the Asian countries. About the foundation, before I go into the foundation, I start my personal, because that is my journey to get into the foundation. So, and you mentioned about the FGM legislation in Ireland. I started because of my personal experience. Mm-hmm. I came to Ireland and as a refugee. Mm-hmm. And it was really hard to go through on medical check and all that.
I've heard you say before, you know, obviously refugees would face medical screenings, etc. But in Ireland here, there was little to no knowledge of FGM and it, that was your experience. That.
Yeah, it was because, you know, like when you're a refugee or asylum and you come to the country, you have to go through on a medical check. Mm-hmm. And it's for every person who comes to seek asylum here. So when I came, I was explained that I have to go through on medical check. And I have to accept it because I was even under minor because I was 17. And then I said, okay. And I remember I have to do blood tests and all that. And then I have to do something called smear test, which I never know. And in culturally, in my country, the women who does the smear test, it's just women who are married, who's pregnant, who have babies and things like that. But I didn't know I had a choice to say no or anything, but I have to accept everything I was told.
I see.
And because my translator also was a man, which is really hard. Mm-hmm. And then I went to room with two female first, and then I was told to lie down on the bed, which I did, and then they wanted to do the test. But soon the lady took the thing that she was trying to take the sample. Mm-hmm. She just screamed, saying, "Jesus Christ," and, you know, she looked completely shocked. And then I was like, why? And she was asking me, like, what happened to me? How did I get this and all that kind of things? And then I was completely shocked because, you know, for me it's something normal.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
As a young girl, and I was actually kind of saying that this is normal, is mm-hmm. actually something that every young woman goes through.
Mm-hmm.
And the lady, she called other doctors, and then last minute, I found the people were surrounding me and just keep asking all these questions.
Mm-hmm.
And I get really upset because I didn't know, you know, when you explained about things, only thing I know when I was in Africa was HIV/AIDS. And I remember people were saying that people who have HIV/AIDS, they can die and things
mm-hmm.
like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, things comes to my head. It's like, do I
of
actually
course.
Have it? Or
yeah.
are they going to tell me now you're going to die or
yes.
things like
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
So it was really hard. And then I looked around and the guy was saying, oh, they're asking you how this has happened. And I was keep saying that this is, you know, my culture and
yeah.
this is normal.
Yeah.
But it was very hard for those people to understand.
Mm-hmm. I would say a very disconcerting experience, quite a frightening experience, when a medical professional is exclaiming and freaking out, and you know, and it's something that yeah, that you would think they would have knowledge of, and
yeah, I mean, like you think it's like now I know because a lot of people actually need to be educated, and it's not necessary that you know. The whole country should know, but like people who works in a medical profession, mm-hmm. as you said, mm-hmm. should be aware of it. But it was really hard. And then for me, I could not take it everything. And then I went back because I was in a hostel. I was with another 18 young refugees who were from different countries.
Mm-hmm.
And mostly we were in, you know, country where the FGM is practiced.
Mm-hmm.
So... And everybody, actually, I believe that every woman who was there, they have been through such trauma in their own way. And I felt that maybe I should ask. And I was asking questions, even, you know, we weren't speaking the same language, but we knew we all in one common, which is, you know, being a refugee, you know. Then I was chatting with them and all of a sudden girls start crying and then everybody started, you know, explaining how they go through on female circumcision.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember one of the girl from Guinea,
mm-hmm.
she actually described how she was cut.
Mm-hmm.
The way she actually described was kind of a broken glass.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
She said that she was cut on that, and on top of that, she was actually put it to heal some kind of traditional stuff,
mm-hmm.
not even sew it.
Mm-hmm.
So in my head, it's coming all those things back saying, it happened to me, but my grandmother, brother did to me, who was actually a doctor. And I didn't have all the necessary, you know, injection to kill the pain or anything. But I was cut and I was actually sewed back.
Mm-hmm.
But looking at this woman saying that she was cut with a broken glass, that even... In my head, I actually could not take it anymore because it was too much. I mean, thinking of like all these beautiful women sitting in one room and talking
yeah.
about how they've gone through and, you know, hearing such things. So I said, you know what? We have to talk about, we have to tell these people that this is our culture and this is normal.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we can get the help we need.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that is actually... whole reason I
started
actually to become the spokesperson of the campaign
mm-hmm.
without knowing where I'm going to start,
mm-hmm.
without knowing what consequence I will face within the community, not only, you know, the community that I'm from, but the rest of the community who practice on the issue.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt that I need to start somewhere that people can understand.
Yeah.
So that was the community that I was from. So I actually went to one of the Somali leaders in Ireland and I said, I need to speak to the women's group and I need to tell them that and also know about their feelings on female genital mutilation and their feelings about living in Ireland because now we come to new culture and we have to actually learn and we have to teach them.
Mm-hmm.
Then we organized a women group and then there was also a man there because, you know, whatever we do, I believe that the men are the solution. So because, you know, they are the part of the life.
Mm-hmm.
And also when we say women are actually making decisions. Mm-hmm. The man also make decision for the child. Mm-hmm. So we invite them, and during the talk, I remember there was old man was sitting there, and he said to me, "Okay, now you are trying to say that."
This was in Ireland.
Dublin.
This was among a Somali community.
Within the Somali community.
Yeah.
They say, now you are trying to actually say that FGM should not be practiced in Ireland, because if I don't cut my daughter, which means I will not have the, you know, the dowry, which is like
an inheritance, like, or like, so as I understand it, one of the reasons why this practice continues, that, you know, in order for there to be a dowry or a like an inheritance of some kind, that the FGM has to have occurred on the wife to be.
Yeah, I mean, like, for example, the father said that if I don't cut my daughter, I will not have the dowry, which is, in a cultural way, if the father gives his daughter to somebody who's mm-hmm. going to marry her, he's expecting to get maybe 100 camels, mm-hmm. which he say that, hey, I will not get the best price. Mm-hmm. But also is a sexuality control, because they say that if the young girls are not cut and mutilated, when she grows, she will go above and then she will, you know, become sex addicted or whatever. And then that is not true, because there is a million women around the world who are not cut and they live in their life the way they want. But is it because of, you know, and also some people, they say it's a religion, but it has nothing to do with religion. Mm-hmm. It's a cultural practice.
Yes.
It's a traditional. It's a mentality of mother for many generation who felt that, you know, she felt that my grandmother was cut, my mother was cut, my auntie was cut, mm-hmm. I am cut.
Yes.
My daughter have to go through.
Yes, yeah.
So it's just allowing that pain to your child.
Yes, yeah.
So it's really hard to actually get into that on your head. And then mm-hmm. that is why, for example, Somalia is a 98% girls are cut.
Yes, yeah.
Which is really high number, you know. Mm-hmm. 98% is only 2 girls that are not cut. If you look at the whole other women's, you know, if you look generation to generation, all of them, they've been cut. So is a culture that actually have in power to the community and the society. Mm-hmm. And mother also sometimes is... they play a big role, because it's like saying, I've been through this and you have to go through. Yeah. And mothers are allowing their child to suffer. Yeah. And first, she knows when she gets first time her period, she knows the pain. Mm-hmm. Second, when she got married, she knows the pain she will feel. When she have the baby, she knows the pain. When actually, you know, because... FGM is actually, the consequence she will have is that kidney failure, mm-hmm. different infections, mm-hmm. You know, giving birth to child and
yeah.
during the marriage, people can die for different
yes,
consequence.
Yeah. As you say, it causes huge issues with even simple bodily functions, and then, you know, processes of birth, menstruation, urination, etc. It causes huge, huge issues for the rest, possibly for the rest.
It has an impact on your life.
Mm-hmm.
For me, even as an activist now, I moved on being a victim, to be a survivor and to become, you know, a spokesperson. But it still, actually, it has an impact in my life, because whenever I think about it, I just feel like it's in your body in many different ways, mm-hmm. whether you have your period or whether you have a, you know, baby or whether... So it's just... it's a trauma, and it's actually physical and emotional. Is mm-hmm. It affects your life.
So can I ask, you said a big moment was when you were speaking to other women who had been through that on this side, so in Ireland, and then that kind of reawakening, you know, elements of that trauma. Is it something that women share and talk about in Somalia, share with each other what that experience is like, and the significance of that, and that as a traumatic thing and as something that is...
No. The issue is that in Somalia, you know, we grew up in a culture and we grew up in a tradition. It's just normal. For example, now as you know, working on Ifrah Foundation and working in Somalia,
mm-hmm.
A mother died during her, you know, baby delivery,
mm-hmm.
or she has a fistula, they actually say that her time is up. Nobody acknowledges that what she have been through.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, let's say the women in IDBs, in a personal displaced, come, if she's having a baby and she doesn't have the facility to go to hospital or even, you know, anyone to deliver the baby as fast as possible, she could actually cut pushing the baby and she can bleed for that. And, you know, the people there, they just say she died.
I have to say, I mean, it's harrowing. I mean, it wasn't so long ago we had legislation here in Ireland that would have allowed for the very same thing, you know. And I don't know, a practice like, as you describe it, and this is just from my opinion, I mean, it's something that punishes women for being women.
Exactly.
At birth or in their young ages. We still have practices here that oftentimes in Western countries just punish women after they have engaged in sexuality, you know. But can I ask you, what year did you arrive into Ireland?
I came to Ireland in 2006.
In 2006?
Yes.
And within 6 years, you were elemental in ensuring that legislation passed in Ireland that banned the practice here.
Yes, because I felt that whatever happened to me, that should not happen to young girls who are born and raised in Ireland. And I make sure that this message, Irish government get it, the medical get it, and also, you know, everyone who cares get them this message about protecting young girls who are born and raised in Ireland, because they don't have to go through the pain we all been through. So I've been naughty. I mean, like, I remember when I started the campaign, I didn't know where to start, but I had a young African group and I set up a youth club called United Youth of Ireland, and then through United Youth of Ireland, I felt that what young people can do is fashion and, you know, talents and things like that. And I felt it was very important that, because what you're talking about is a sensitive subject on female genital mutilation. So I felt, how can I actually steal the heart of the young people? And then we set up different, you know, activities in terms of talents and fashion show and all that. And then I started with small group, and then I felt that it was going really big. And then I seen, you know, we became big on social media, just sharing photos and things like that. And then I felt that, you know what, it works. And then we started a beauty pageant called Miss Ethnic Ireland. And then we just had, and also we had no money, we had nothing, but we could have the best hotels to actually go and have events. And because I meet a lot of people who do care the cause and support us in different way.
Give you a space.
Spaces to organize things. And then when I feel the young people are taken in, that is when I found it that we should then talk to Irish government, because the FGM bill, it was in the parliament since 2001.
I see. Okay.
So it was just there.
Okay.
It was not something just to start.
Yeah.
So imagine in 2001 till 2006, it was under the table.
Yeah.
So for me, it is my culture, but it is something that we can actually destroy it and say this should not be actually happening in this country or elsewhere. Then I started actually said, who is the good person to lobby on the Irish government? And I was so lucky, I meet with Joe Castlow and then his wife, who was then the mayor of Dublin. And one night we were hosting one of the beauty pageants, and then she was mayor of Dublin. And I said, oh, Joe was supposed to come and he couldn't make it. Then he actually said, if my wife comes. And I was like, even, you know, much better, because she was then mayor of Dublin. I was like, that's good.
Yeah.
And she came, and then she became a member of European Parliament.
Okay.
And actually she took our voice into European level.
I see. Just back on, and the first conversations that you had here, when you started speaking to people, did you find here in Ireland that when you spoke to women from the Somali community that they were willing, and this was a topic they wanted to address, and that, you know, or was it difficult at first?
The problem is that, you know, when you look at and you say this is man's show, it just says, like, because women are married, women have a father, women have a grandfather, and they believe that if they speak out, the man, they may against them. So even if they want to speak out, they cannot speak openly. So from beginning, the whole community has against me, actually. Mm-hmm. Not only necessarily they have Somalis, but every country that actually practice on FGM would call me and say a lot of bad things. Mm-hmm. Even I was told that I was going to be killed and things like that. I lived in Dublin and I have to move from Dublin to Drogheda just to escape. But I have to come back again and say, no, I am not going to run away. Because first time when I came to Ireland, I was told I have a voice. And, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. I said, you know what? I am going to go back and say I have a voice. So I come back and continue the work.
The Cry Power podcast will explore the UN's 17 global goals, a series of objectives that aims to end extreme poverty, reduce inequality, and tackle climate change by 2030. To take action on any of these issues we talk about on the show, go to globalcitizen.org/crypower and get involved. So you said the Ifrah Foundation was set up in 2010. Yeah. I mean, 2012 that legislation was passed. So, I mean, it's incredible. Very short period of time. As a result of that legislation, the very first trial has only just occurred now. It's December last month, only a few weeks ago, I believe, the first couple will be taken to court for performing FGM on their daughter, on their one-year-old daughter, I believe. So, you know, that's already a very, very tangible, you know. It's
really great because, you know, it's sad that because, you know, young girl, she's already been damaged. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But it shows that the legislation is working. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the family have damaged little girl, but they have to face the consequence. Mm-hmm. But it's still, you know, the issue is that the consequence and the life damage that little girl will live rest of her life, the family, they might go to prison. Mm-hmm. And come out in certain time.
Yeah, yeah.
But hair is growing. It's forever.
Yeah.
So it's very important that we should actually find a way that, you know, people to inform that there is a legislation, but they cannot practice.
Of course. I know the three main goals for the Ifrah Foundation. And I mean, one, what there is because of this legislation, I suppose, I know education and awareness is one of the main goals for the Ifrah Foundation. I know there's awareness, advocacy, and community empowerment. So.
Yeah. So, for example, now, because I went back to Somalia, because I felt that I remember sitting in European Parliament with the European Commission and Home Affairs and a lot of Member of Parliament and some of the ministers, and, you know, saying, you know, if there was an Irish person in the room, how much they will be proud of you as, you know, champion of being the voice and becoming a voice for the whole European level. So I felt that, okay, if I had a voice in Ireland and I could do something in Europe, mm-hmm. I could do something in Somalia. Mm-hmm. So I went back to Somalia first time when I get my passport.
What year was this? Do you mind me
asking? In 2014.
Okay.
That's when I actually got my passport. And I went to Somalia knowing nothing where I'm going to start. Because, you know, a country that I ran away because of the war and country that still is in danger and all that. I just went there because I get sponsored by in Ireland. So I went there and in 20 days, I spent it in IDBs. Mm-hmm. This 20...
IDBs?
The personal displaced.
Okay, yes, yeah.
I spent it there because I wanted to understand how young girls are growing and how female genital mutilation is practiced in the IDBs. So my 20 days, it was all about buying sweets, buying balls and mm-hmm. playing with kids and just being happy with those kids. And then I remember the practice was big in Somalia still. And I remember I met with three little girls that who was going through cutting in 2 days later after. And I was so upsetting because, you know, as an activist, I could not really let that happen. Mm-hmm. So I have to save those girls whichever way I can. So I was, I went back and I called my friend. I was like, okay, there is a girl that will be cut on Friday. What can I do? And I say, follow your heart and do what you feel like doing. and you know a country that you already told that the dangers and, you know, things can happen. Mm-hmm. And you,
and you had been receiving threats of every kind, you know, while you were in Ireland for
And the funny thing is that before I even went to Somalia, I did interview with Irish Times. And then Irish Times was on the biggest Somali website, actually linked with it. And then already people knew that that my cousin, including my family, you know, and it was so, I didn't know how to deal with all that. So I, end of the day, I really want to save the girls. Yeah. And that's what I wanted. And the guy said to me, follow your heart. So I was like, okay, what can I do? I find the best solution quicker. And I have to actually meet with the family. Because first thing I need to know was $100, how much money is Somali money?
Yeah.
So $100 was like more than 10 million or 4 million, 5 million Somali money.
Yes, yeah.
And this woman who cut in her daughter, she works, she goes domestic work in the morning and she earned maybe $1. So $100 is a lot of money.
It's a lot of money.
Then I went to them and I say, okay, I give you money if you don't cut your daughter. But a lot of questions come back to me. Why do you want not to cut? Mm-hmm. Have you not been cut? Mm-hmm. What's your beneficial, and all that?
What's your agenda here? What's your motivation?
Then I have to say I was not cut and I lived in Nairobi and I told them that I was told that it's very bad and risk and danger and all that. And then, oh yeah, give us the money, we're not going to cut. Okay. I was like, no way, I'm not going to give you the money till we have the deal done,
yes,
you know,
yeah.
that I know the girls are not cut. So one way to actually do that was making everyone to swear the Holy Quran.
Okay, okay.
So, you know, that was not really the best solution forever, but something I could do quicker.
Yeah, yeah.
I have to pay $300 for three families, and I have to save that three girls. But same time, I could not stay in the IDBs, the prisoner displaced, because imagine I did that, and they told all the neighbors that, oh, this lady's giving money.
Giving out $100 for
not cutting your daughter. And then they have a girls who are cut, and they lined up, and they said, give us the money. It was very hard.
Mm-hmm.
But still, I said, if I can save one girl's life, I will continue being here. And, you know, my voice has made a difference because, as you said, the awareness and then education for the community and all that. I did advocacy and awareness with the religious leaders, media. So I worked with the Global Media Campaign. Is actually, it was set up under The Guardian in UK. And now they become an separate entity, and now it's called GMC, Global Media Campaign. And the leader is actually a former Irish journalist, very well known, Maggie O'Kane.
Okay.
And I remember when I meet with her, I say, Maggie, are we... When I meet her here, and I say, can you do something in Somalia? And she say, no, I am not going to Somalia. She said, I've been in Bosnia, I reported war zone. I am not going to Somalia. Mm-hmm. I have a girl to raise. No, Ifrah, I am not going.
Mm-hmm.
Then I was like, okay, no problem. Maybe you can support me to do something.
Yeah.
But GMC was actually working in six African countries, including Nigeria and Kenya and then Gambia. And I just wanted that, you know, to have that opportunity other activists have in Somalia.
Have that support, yeah.
But, you know, I was so lucky to change Maggie's hair. I went to her, I take her to Somalia. Mm-hmm. First time we went to a place called Woodland and we educate 60 people, from religious leader to media to civil society. The one we did in Woodland, we supposed to have in Mogadishu, but there was a car bomb which killed 1,000 people. October 2017, and injured 500.
Oh my goodness.
So Maggie was shocked because I was just worried about Maggie because, you know, it was very sad. But then we decided we're not going to go.
Mm-hmm.
But in 2000 and, we went, I took Maggie to Mogadishu, actually.
After this?
Yeah. And this is what happened. We did the trip.
You're not to be deterred.
You see, the
You're
Irish.
Nothing,
but
nothing.
I said, you know, Irish people are not different from Somalia because they're crazy. So because Maggie said she was not going to Somalia because she'd been reporting in war zone and she has a girls to raise.
Yeah.
But, but we were so good and we were so lucky as the Ifrah Foundation to save 20 girls to death for bleeding.
Oh.
And in 2018. I remember it was my birthday and I was in Morocco with Sammy Leslie and I get a phone call about different areas for young girls because our documentary, we've been actually broadcast national and international level and we used so much on social media. So people really get the message and people on rural area, we had message on the radios. Like for example, VOA, they did interview with me and then... what they call BBC, and then all local radios. Mm-hmm. So the family of daughters, when they cut their girl and they find out this girl who died for bleeding, they rush to hospital. Mm-hmm. So I was asked if I could support them. So we saved the 20 girls for dying for bleeding, sending in different hospital.
Yeah.
And that was really good because, you know, at least the people get the message.
Mm-hmm.
No stopping, but... if they cut and the child is bleeding, they run to hospital.
Yes, yeah. Something you had said earlier on in relation to FGM, in that it's a conversation that you have to bring men into because it is a practice that is perpetuated by men. It is, and it's also a mentality. It's men seeking to control women's bodies and women's sexuality. And similar with violence against women, which is that is perpetrated by men, a conversation that requires bringing men into it. In your view, what is it that men could be doing to better educate themselves and to help out on that issue?
I think the all men can become a champion. Like even, look, you just mentioned about gender-based violence. And if you actually organize something on GBV, let's talk about even Ireland, because there is a conference about gender-based violence. And mostly there will be women and you can see only one or two men because man feels that this is women's issue. But till that mentality of this is women issue, nothing will change. Not because of female genital mutilation, but gender-based violence. When men are involved is when actually, because men are part of the solution. Because, you know, they are actually there to make the decision as well. And also the other, some of the men, not all, but some of the men who are actually violated for women. So they should be part of the conversation and they should not see this is women's issue. Till that it stops women's issue, nothing will actually go right because man sees this is women's issue. And actually on female genital mutilation, also the father is the one who makes his decision. So he have to be involved and he have to be the champion. And I think we have, like for example, Barkad, he is Somalian actor. Abdi Barkad, and he is on the movie, and you know he is a great support. I mean, like he believes that FGM should not be practiced, but we need more men to say no, and then that you know, it will be possible to actually end.
If you find yourself inspired or angry, this podcast isn't just about talking; it's about making change happen, and you can do that right now. You can head to globalcitizen.org/crypower to take action on these issues. This is Hozier, and you're listening to my Cry Power podcast. I believe, is it out in March of 2020? There's a film based around your story. The girl from Mogadishu?
Yeah.
It was received positively among
oh,
among
yeah, the yeah. I mean, like, you see, my story, it might be mine, but it was a story connected with a lot of women because... there was a question and answer, and then I never had a long question and answer what we had in Nairobi because there was a lot of people want to ask questions. And then also, most of the women who spoke out, they say that you are telling our story, you are telling our mother's story. So that actually how I believed myself, that I am not just telling my story, I'm telling the story of every woman in you know, the society that... where all this issue come from. So that was really good and positive. And it was, hopefully we will take next year in Nairobi again, and then Somalia, as I hope. And then how the movie came out. I met with the Irish filmmaker in France. There was a lady who did a documentary called Too Much Pain. It was for UNHCR. And Too Much Pain, it was talking about female genital mutilation. So the lady said that, no, she was in, they do some work with the young African filmmakers. So she said to me, you should come to Monaco. And they were doing something during the Cannes Film Festival. So she said to me, you should come and meet with the directors and filmmakers and, you know, everyone and see what you can do beyond. So we chat and she say, are you a filmmaker? Or she asked me questions and then I say, no, I am not that part of the world. I am actually an activist. And I told her what I do. And then I remember we've been backward and forward and she asked me if I could sit on the front of the camera and actually give my testimony about, you know, on my life. And then we were in Galway. I remember there was a film festival in Galway and I was in a hotel for 2 days just sitting in front of the camera and talking about...
Intense few days.
Yeah, just sitting there and talking about the whole issues that happened in Somalia and, you know, my life being a refugee and how I get my voice in this country and how I become, you know, champion for campaigning on FGM. And I remember Mary say, Ifrah, I cannot promise, but I will do something that really means something to you and to the world. And in my head, whenever she says to me, I don't know what I can do, but, you know, because she felt it was taking time. I just think of, like, you know, for me as a woman who been, like, if you think about Somalia, first thing people comes to head is, especially young Irish, if you ask about Somalia, the first thing they get in their head is the pirates.
Okay, right, yeah.
Because I went to different places and I was like, I ask a lot of young people, I say, do you know Somalia? And they say, come here, that the place with the Somali
pirates.
And then, you know,
rock stars of the criminal world, I suppose, yeah.
So the first thing people come in the head is the pirate. And then, you know, the war. And then also, for me, being a refugee, all these kind of things. Mm-hmm. So me, when Mary says, oh, I see what I can do, things comes to my head is that, women who is a refugee, women who actually people says that you're from the pirate country, or women who people says that you actually refugee in there. So I don't know if it's possible to do something, but she really made it to be possible. And then she made the movie and it's really positive. And it might be my story, as I always say, but it's a story of every woman.
Absolutely. It's a story of countless women, you know, I'm sure. I'd love to ask you as well, just because, you know, the times we're living now at the moment, there is, you know, like a global refugee crisis. And just you're speaking to your experience as a refugee and as a refugee who came to Ireland as a refugee. What was that experience like for you coming into Ireland? And I'm sure the trip there, incredibly difficult one, but for people not only in Ireland, but people in other countries who want to make it a more welcoming space and provide a more welcoming space and make that transition easier for people who are seeking a new home and a safe place to call home.
It's good you ask, because, you know, this take me back to when I first come to Ireland. And because I remember, because I wear a scarf, and I go and take a bus and my daily life and just do things that people do. I go to English class and all that. And then sometimes when I go in different areas and I take the bus, young people, they just pull my scarf. They throw things. And I never been angry, but I felt that I should tell them why I am here. And it was very important for me to actually meet with the youth. And then the place I was going to English classes, I told them that I want to share my personal refugee status to the Irish young people. So I went to schools. I carry a lot of scarves.
Right.
And then boys, girls, I just tell them to wear the scarves. And then also, because I worked with the YMCA youth, I worked with National Youth Council of Ireland, I worked with different schools in Ireland. I just went to voluntary my time to educate them and just talk about.
Is this recently or is this when you...
When I first came to Ireland.
How did you... Because again, there's not... I mean, there's fantastic like initiative and leadership in getting to the point where you're engaging in local schools and talking to children about your experience. How did you get to that point?
Well, because you know, I said, like when they pulled my scarf, I never been angry, but I felt that I have to share my experience. So I just went and tell them that I am refugee. Mm-hmm. I left my country because there is a war. Mm-hmm. I came here for better life. And then talk about, you know, 100,000 of Irish people who left the country to seek a better life. Mm-hmm. And ask them questions. How would they feel if they were in America and they were told that, go back to your country or, you know, such things. Yeah. And they say, that's no good. Mm-hmm. I said, I'm like that. Mm-hmm. Put me in that way. Mm-hmm. And this is my identity because I'm a Muslim woman. I wear this scarf. Because I was born to where I was grow up and all that. Mm-hmm. So I felt that I am one of the global citizens and I have to actually adopt this culture and educate the people around me. Mm-hmm. So I never ever say that because, you know, sometimes when people talk about racism and things like that, I just get angry. I say, look, don't say that. Don't say Irish people are racist or young people are racist. Just go and educate them. Mm-hmm. Just make them understand you personal, mm-hmm. why you're here. Mm-hmm. But they will understand.
And how can, let's say, for me as an Irish person or other people who are in other countries that will be accepting, possibly will be accepting, you know, refugees, how can they be more welcoming, or how can they make that transition easier for people coming into the country, I suppose?
You know, when I came to Ireland, I didn't like about bread and butter. I never know what complex is, but yeah, I eat complex.
It's very bland, you know? To be fair.
But the truth is that if I want to leave this country, I have to actually adopt that all and say, you know what, this is now my new life. Mm-hmm. So for me, because people, they say that you are a very happy person because, for example, if I'm silent and I go somewhere, they say, what's wrong with you today? Mm-hmm. What is that, you know, smiley face? I just go like, no, I am tired. So, you know, people kind of know me, somebody who's very charming and just talkative and all that. So for me, you know, whatever has happened to me has happened. Mm-hmm. I cannot carry my past with me. Mm-hmm. I have, you know, life to lead, and mm-hmm. I have things to learn. So I just moved my past and I wanted to do something new and try things. And also, integration is the, you know, the best key. And because I was lucky, I was going to English class, and the English class, they helped me to go into the community and talk to them. So yeah. I actually force myself because I want to learn quick so I can do work. I can speak out.
Mm-hmm. Ifrah, thank you so much for joining us for the Cry Power podcast. Can I ask you what you're most proud of in the last few years?
Actually for FGM bill passed in Ireland, mm-hmm. and legislate. I remember I was somewhere in town and I get a phone call from Joe Costello and he said to me, the bill is passed. I sit down on the ground and I just cried for happiness because I've been campaigning a lot and, you know, I've been sitting on the table with the debates and all that. And I feel that now, you know, the bill has passed and this will make sure no girl will go through on female circumcision. So that is something I was very proud of, and because I was blackmailed by the community. I've been fighting for hard. I've been campaigning a lot. And now I feel that, you know, it has been paid off. So that is something I can say I was so proud.
I'm glad. And can you, so just for listeners as well at home, if they want to support the Ifrah Foundation, where would they head to?
Well, we have Ifrah Foundation website, and it's ifrahfoundation.org. Mm-hmm. And also they can find us on Twitter, and they can find us on Facebook. I always say that when we ask support, not only money that actually do something, but Tesco say every little helps. So everything that, you know, people can support is, you know, bringing message out and telling people and whatever support they can give to the foundation, because we are making a difference for lives of young girls who are going through female genital mutilation and who are at risk.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us.
Is made in association with Global Citizen, a movement of activists all over the world who are using their collective voice to end extreme poverty by 2030. You can head to globalcitizen.org/crypower to take action on any of the issues we talk about on this show and earn tickets to gigs all over the world by signing petitions, writing emails, or sending tweets to world leaders. Don't forget, you can subscribe to the Cry Power podcast on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to podcasts right now. Thank you so much for joining me. This is Hozier, and this is Cry Power.